Hello people, in this video let's look at femoral hernia. So femoral hernia is one of the types of hernia. Look at this image. So people, here you can see that this one is a femoral hernia. It is lateral and below, okay, your pubic tubercle. So you, here is the pubic tubercle, right? So this femoral hernia is lateral and below, okay, to the pubic tubercle. However, the normal inguinal hernias, they are medial and above the pubic tubercle, which you can see here, right? It is going to be more medial, right, towards the midside of the pubic tubercle, and it is above. Did you understand? So femoral is where? Below and lateral. This much you understood? Very good. Look at this image here. So basically here they are showing you again, this is the pubic tubercle. So guess which one is the inguinal hernia? This is the inguinal hernia, and this will be the femoral hernia, because the lateral one will be the femoral one, right? So look at how the femoral hernia is coming. Okay, see, the bubble is, or whatever they have shown you, a bubble is going through the femoral ring, which is here. Then it's going through the femoral canal, and here you have the saphenous opening in the fascia, right? It is coming out of that. So it is going like how? No wonder it is not that common. But in females, this is common. Okay, this is you see femoral hernias more in females. So, in males or females, the most common will be the indirect inguinal hernias, okay? Indirect inguinal hernias are more common in both male and female. When it comes to femoral hernia, you will see more femoral hernia in females, okay? Femoral hernias are more common in females. So, did you understand that, guys? So, here you can see how it is going via the femoral ring, femoral canal, and coming out of this saphenous opening, isn't it? So this is your femoral hernia. If somebody asks you the content of the femoral canal, right, look at this. What do you have here? Are you able to see, guys? You have in the blue, you have a vein, guys. You have a, here you can see in the canal, what do you have? If somebody asks, you will say that you have the vein, artery, and a nerve, right? So, if you go like this, it's van. There's also a lymph node here called as a Clockett's lymph node. So, you have the lymph node, vein, artery and nerve. Here, they are showing you the femoral canal they have marked here. Here, the vein and the artery they have shown here. This is the saphenous opening. Okay, then what else is there here as a photo? Let's look at another photo here. So, here they are showing the hernia and the contents also they are showing here. The vein, the artery and the nerve, right? So here they are showing the femoral canal. There is a lymph node also which they are showing here. So lymph node also you have understood. Then what else? Do you have any other photo for femoral hernia? So let's come back to the textbook and look at this. Femoral hernias in women, they are more common. Okay, especially in Paris women. That is people who have given a lot of birth, or they have carried to term kind of a thing. Isn't it? So what is this Paris telling you here? So it's telling you, because these people will have some relaxin hormone, this femoral hernia is more common in women. Guys, what are we looking at? Femoral hernia, in whom is it more common? It's more common in women, okay, especially in people who have given birth. In women, inguinal hernia are the most common type. Most common type in men or women is inguinal hernia, but femoral hernias, where will you see more in women, okay? Then femoral hernia is third common most type of hernia, which is the second. The second is the incisional hernia after a surgery or something, okay? So commonly this is unilateral, okay, and the right side is affected more. So just remember that in femoral hernias, right side is affected more. What is the anatomy of the femoral canal and the femoral ring? You already saw that you have that lymph node, vein, artery and the nerve. Which ones you should know? Which one? This lymph node is the lymph node of Clockwart. Then you have the femoral vein, femoral nerve, which is that artery, guys, femoral artery, okay. So you have everything is femoral, so no need to remember except this lymph node of Clockwart, which has a specific name. Other things which are there in this canal are the fat and the fascia. How? Okay. And then it is lateral to the pubic tubercle. So the hernia is also formed lateral to the pubic tubercle. Okay. So it is narrow at the femoral ring. Remember, it is narrow at the femoral ring. Just like how you have in that inguinal hernia, you have the internal ring and the external ring, that is the deep ring and the superficial ring. Here also there is a ring, and that's the femoral ring. And it just tries to come out of this ring, you know. So that is what is the same kind of situation. It's trying to come out of a existing opening kind of thing. But anyways, they're not using the word indirect, etc. here. Now, what else? Femoral sheath is also there. They're talking about femoral sheath. Fascia transversalis is continued downwards behind the inguinal ligament as an anterior layer of the femoral sheath. Fascia iliaca. Fascia iliaca continues behind the femoral vessels as the posterior layer of the femoral sheath. That just became too much, isn't it? Okay, now let us look at the boundaries of the femoral ring. Let us try to establish this. There's a femoral ring, then there's a canal. What is there anteriorly? Inguinal ligament. That kind of makes sense to me. Posteriorly, what is there? Ligament of Cooper. Iliopectineal ligament. Posteriorly, some ligament is there. Ligament of Cooper. Iliopectineal ligament. Medially, what is there, guys? Posteriorly, do you want me to represent? Okay. Then medially, you have the lacunar ligament. That is the Gimbarat's ligament, and laterally you have the thin septum which separates the femoral canal from the femoral vein. Okay, this is called a silver fascia. Wow, they found a nice name for it. Silver fascia. What does silver fascia do? It separates this canal, femoral canal, from the femoral vein. Very good. Look at this femoral sheath, guys. They are showing here. The femoral sheath, they are showing this here. Note the asymmetry of the femoral sheath. What and all there? You have vein and artery, and then some nerve should be there. Yes, nerve also they have indicated. So in this, they're showing you the compartments. Look at this. So here you have the median septum. The entire thing is the sheath, right? Then you have a lateral septum, lymph node of Cloquet, femoral vein, femoral artery, and femoral branch of the genitofemoral nerve. Okay. Drawing all these diagrams may fetch you a lot of marks, guys. Now, let us look at the femoral hernia coverings. Now, let us say there is a hernia, right? It appears more in the right side. So, now let us take this. This is a hernia. So, from what will you get from outside? You will get skin. Then you will get superficial fascia. Then you have cribriform fascia. Fascia transversalis, fat, lymphoid tissue. And finally, you will get the sac. Can you remember this, guys? Is that easy? Now let us look at the causes of femoral hernia, guys. So you have pregnancy. Pregnancy, we told you, relaxin hormone. So therefore, the person, Paris women, will have more of femoral hernia, right? A gravid uterus compresses the external iliac vein. The empty femoral sheath on the medial side allows the femoral vein to expand within femoral sheath. Increased abdominal pressure due to repeated pregnancy is one of the chief factors responsible for femoral hernias. Okay. So, around 30 to 40 years age, women will have a lot of femoral hernias, remember, because they would have delivered babies, isn't it? So, what exactly is happening in this pregnancy? Let us see. See, there is a femoral vein here. And then here you have the external iliac vein, right? So, what is supposed to happen? All the blood is supposed to go like this. But now there's a gravid uterus which is putting a lot of pressure here. So what happens, this femoral vein is going to expand and the femoral sheath which is there, it is going to make way for the femoral vein to expand. And when this lady is having repeated pregnancies, has increased abdominal pressure, the contents are able to come out of the femoral canal. This is what it looks like. And in few cases, looks like the canal itself will be very wide. Wide femoral canal, okay. So that is a few things. Femoral hernia is never congenital. It is acquired, is it? So this canal is wide as an acquired thing, is it? Okay. Course of the hernial sac. See what happens, the ring and the canal quite narrow. But when it comes out of the saphenous opening, now it can become knife. So what it says is it expands. When it comes out of the saphenous opening, the hernia, that part, that content, it will expand and become retort shaped. Okay. So let's look at the femoral hernia. Focus, guys, look at this. So what is happening here? Initially, this is very narrow for it, but here the opening is big and nice. So it is expanding here, the content. Okay. Look at the clinical features, guys. Females 20 to 40 years, they're commonly affected, especially if they've delivered so many times. Let us say gore sign. There is some gore sign. There is dilatation of the superficial epigastric circumflex iliac veins. So you can understand the veins seem to be affected here, right? Due to compression. Right side is more commonly affected because of the dominant nature of the right side of the body. Okay, right side is affected more. We already saw this. Unilateral, it will be mostly right side affected. There's a gore sign. Means what? The veins are dilated, right? Dilatation of the veins, some of these veins. To start with, there's a small swelling and then it becomes big, right? Initially, they will not notice it. So expansal impulse is not present because it's a narrow canal, right? It has to come through a narrow canal, so it will not have impulse when they cough or something. It will not expand in size or something. Reducibility may be present. You may be able to reduce it if there are no adhesions, right? So this can help you differentiate it from an inguinal hernia, isn't it? This expansile sign. Are you understanding, people? Typically, the swelling is below and lateral to the pubic tubercle. We already saw this. And they may present with strangulation, obviously, because this ring and canal are so narrow, isn't it? They may have strangulation. Time has already come for reading the treatment of femoral hernia, guys. So, femoral hernia, how do you treat? Let's look at this. Some low operation of Lockwood. The inguinal ligament is sutured to the Cooper ligament. So, there is some Lockwood low operation. Then there is some inguinal incision. There is inguinal operation. Then you have some high operation of McEVD and Henry's approach, which is the treatment of choice for femoral hernia. There you do some lower midline for bilateral hernia. Everything is going above the head weight. So look at this, guys. There is a red line here. This is low. Okay. And there's some high McEVD high approach. Then here you have some inguinal approach, which is also called as Lothiessen inguinal approach. So something below that is the Lockwood low approach, and above that you have some McEVD approach. But apart from all this, the best one is the Henry's approach, which they are saying is lower midline for bilateral hernia. This is only for bilateral, is it? Lower midline. Again, this is low only and it's in the midline. Okay. So did you get the treatment, guys? Just mention the names at least. Hello people, look at the summary for the surgery for femoral hernia. It should be done as early as possible because they are fearing, are they fearing strangulation in this? So, for elective repair, low femoral approach. Okay. Transinguinal or this Lothiessen approach, we saw this, right? Everything up, above and below, this only they are talking about. Did you get it? So, this one, Lothiessen inguinal approach, this one. So, below this only they are saying it is low Lockwood, and above something they are saying high approach McEVD, right? But this one, when are they doing? Whenever there is gangrene, but this can weaken the inguinal. What is it? Inguinal? What can it weaken? It can weaken the inguinal canal. So, it can be used when there is gangrene. However, it may weaken inguinal canal. Guys, look at this spelling. Low thigh sen. Remember this? This is transinguinal. Then you have a combined approach, etc. If there is a strangulated femoral hernia, they are using some combined approach. Combined is the McEVD, guys. Vertical incision is made over the swelling and extended above the inguinal ligament. Look at this, guys. They are talking something specifically about the obturator artery here. Here you have the obturator artery, which is marked here, which is a branch of this internal iliac artery. Okay. This, they are very concerned about this artery during the surgery. Obturator artery. So, they are trying to tell you to be careful about looking for an abnormal obturator artery when you are doing this procedure. So, basically this artery, what it does, it anastomoses with the pubic branch of the inferior epigastric artery. So, when you go here and check, here you have the inferior epigastric artery that's here. That seems to be coming out of the external iliac artery, isn't it? So, this one and this one, they seem to be giving out some branches which seems to anastomose, okay? Sometimes this anastomosis is large, okay, and the obturator artery then appears to be a branch of the inferior epigastric. It appears to be the branch of the inferior epigastric. It gives the anastomosis so large. So you will think that the obturator artery is coming out of the inferior epigastric, is it? Okay. And then what they are saying is you have this abnormal artery can be lateral to this, wait, let me get this straight. What they are saying, this abnormal artery may lie along the medial margin of the femoral ring and lateral to the femoral canal in contact with the femoral vein. Lateral to the femoral canal in contact with the femoral vein. This kind of makes sense to me. Oh, occasionally it may be medial. Okay, so it can either be medial or lateral. That's what I'm understanding here. Usually it passes lateral to the femoral canal. Okay, so let's go back here. If this is the femoral canal, lateral to it, you can have an artery, right? Somewhere here, lateral to this canal, you can have. Occasionally, it can go medial to the ring. Okay, That's what it looks like, right? Occasionally, the abdominal artery may lie medial margin of the femoral ring. Did we understand it right? Just check this, okay? Along the free margin of the lacunar ligament, this artery is in danger during surgery for obstructed femoral hernia. Okay, which artery? This abdominal obturator artery. We are almost at the end of this video. Don't worry, guys. Let's look at the complications of femoral hernia. So if you don't do all this Lockwood low operation or this inguinal incision, what is that called as Lothiasin, or if you don't do that Henry, or if you don't do that McCavity, what are the complications if you leave this hernia as it is, right? So basically, there can be obstruction and strangulation because this ring and neck of the sac are very narrow, isn't it? There can be Richter's hernia. That means what? Richter's hernia means one part of the circumference of the bowel can get into the hernia. So this can get strangulated without obstruction. So obstruction is not there because there is passage. Obstruction is not there, but strangulation can happen, right? So that is Richter's hernia can happen. Right, portion of the circumference of the bowel is caught within the hernia sac. Right, then what else can happen? So in these people, rather than constipation, you will see diarrhea and gangrene can occur, but you will have to search for the gangrene very carefully because this is the bowel. One side will be proper, the other side would have got caught and become gangrenous. Here they are showing you the Richter hernia, guys. You can see. Let us look at some rare types of femoral hernia. This is femoral in the sense it is in that area. That's it. So here there is a defect in the lacunar ligament and the hernia passes through it. That is called as Logier hernia. Then you have some Naratz hernia. Congenital dislocation of the hip it may be associated with. So where is it? It is located behind the femoral vessels in and the inguinal ligament. So around this area only it is, but it is not coming out through the ring and the canal of the femoral ring or canal looks like. Then you have the Naratz femoral hernia. This we told you in congenital dislocation of hip. Same thing. Same thing, isn't it? Naratz hernia. Same thing we are talking about. Okay. Femoral hernia occurs behind the femoral vessels. Do you remember in the beginning of this video, we saw this. This is femoral hernia. In the same area it is occurring. What are those? Logier hernia. And one more we told was some Naratz hernia, right? So what are the differential diagnosis of femoral hernia? Will you see some mass there and suddenly say it is femoral hernia? No, it could be an inguinal hernia. It could be a saphena varix, same thing, right? The vein is not draining. So what will happen? The vein would have become more in size, right? That could be one of the causes. So it will be dilated saccular, right? Then thrill may be felt on coughing. It disappears on lying. Why? Because of gravity, the vein will drain. Venous drainage will happen. It could be a lipoma. Very similar to any hernia, what are the differential diagnoses? Femoral artery aneurysm. So the artery itself would have become balloon like this, isn't it? Or the swelling could actually be an enlarged lymph node, isn't it? Anybody will guess this. Or it could be a bursa, psoas bursa. Osteoarthritis of the hip can produce distension of psoas bursa. So, and also what are they saying? Tuberculosis spine can present as iliopsoas abscess. So it could be an abscess, it could be a bursa, it could be a lymph node enlargement, it could be a vein, it could be an aneurysm, anything that can be, look like a swelling, isn't it? Look at the saphena varix. Here they are showing you lipoma. Okay, it could be an inguinal hernia itself. Check whether it's femoral or inguinal. Guys, femoral artery aneurysms they are showing here. This is an aneurysm, so don't confuse it to be a hernia. Then lymphadenitis, same thing showing here. Then psoas bursa. Okay, so when did they talk about the psoas abscess, guys? In tuberculosis. Okay, tuberculosis of the spine. So all these are your differential. Don't immediately think that some swelling is there. Oh, it's femoral hernia. No, these are all differentials. You should be able to differentiate. Okay, let's take a small recap, guys. So femoral hernia occurs in whom? In females. Very good. It's commonly associated with Richter hernia because only one part of the bowel you want to come out means this is the best place for it to come out. So you can have a Richter hernia. Fatty female, small swelling under a big belly. So they have a big belly, a fat female has a big belly, but under that she has a small swelling. It may go undetected. It can be dangerous because of strangulation, because this canal, etc. is so narrow, isn't it? And it is rigid. So it cannot have a lot of space to expand however it wants. Only once it comes out of that saphenous opening, it can expand. Okay, you cannot control it by a truss. What is a truss? Like a bridge kind of thing. You cannot build and you cannot make something here. Surgical repair is must. It's a must. Can you... what else can you do for it? Surgical repair is a must. Must.